first light at 10:30. Now though, John Sargent continues our special night dedicated to the single seater that soars sky high above them all.
We're talking about being British, aren't we? What really matters to us? Fair play? Roast beef? The Queen? Yeah, okay. But I'd like to nominate something quite different, something I've loved all my life, and it's celebrating its 75th birthday. It's the most wonderful, the most beautiful, greatest aircraft in the world. It is, of course, the Spitfire.
A victory roll!
But our story isn't just about a plane, it's about people. The men and women who've loved this thing for three quarters of a century.
It was the nearest thing to flying oneself.
You went into combat daily with it together.
The people who gave the Spitfire its soul.
My Spitfire and me.
Ordinary people who did the most extraordinary things.
Anything that moved short of a horse was an enemy.
Then you would have done the same.
First you hear it, then you feel it. It's so exciting! And does it matter if it's British? Of course it does! I've come here to meet a legend, a British dream machine built by a golden generation. It was going to be called the Shrew. I'm so glad it wasn't.
Are you ready?
Fantastic. There it is, the Spitfire, surely the most beautiful British plane ever built.
The Spitfire looks so beautiful because it was designed for a purpose, a brutal purpose. Brutal and absolutely straightforward and horrible. It had to go at great speed and then bring all the force of its machine guns and cannon onto the enemy aircraft. The key point about the Spitfire, as far as I'm concerned, is it's got this absolute purity of design. And that's why it's so beautiful.
But beauty is only skin deep. I want to get to the heart of the Spitfire story, and this particular Mark IX Spitfire is going to be my guide.
I want to tell the story about this particular Spitfire, the MH434. What did it do in the war? Where did it fly to? And who flew it? And what about all those people whose lives were changed by the Spitfire? The tens of thousands of people who not only liked this plane, they loved it. Now for the really good bit. We're gonna see it fly. Unfortunately, MH434 has only got room for the pilot, but don't worry, we're gonna be up close and personal seeing the Spitfire in its natural habitat in the sky. I'm going to be cruising alongside in formation for the flight of my life. Give me a hand. All right, I'll give it a push. I shouldn't be pushing on that though, should I?
It might weigh more than 3 tons, but pushing it is a joy. And soon we'll be firing up the famous Merlin engine on MH434 one more time. A top-class commercial pilot, Paul Bonham, will have the privilege of flying the Spitfire. And I'll be in the safe hands of Bill Giles, who will fly me in his Aztec. I've been really looking forward to this.
See you later.
All right, Paul. Have a good one.
I learned to fly in a plane like this when I was an RAF cadet. I was called Flight Sergeant Sergeant, if you want to know. Could I fly one of these things now? Only if things go wrong. Hello, Bill. Are you all right?
Right, get cracking.
Prepare for a great journey into the past. We're going back to Spitfire Britain, following the story of one plane, our plane, MH434, as it roars back to some of its wartime haunts. First, we're heading west to the Castle Bromwich factory, where our plane was built in 1943. Then we're off to Hornchurch in Essex, where MH434 took off over 90 times to defend Britain against the Luftwaffe. We'll soar over parts of the most stunning coastline to revisit this Spitfire's battlefield in the sky. And best of all, we'll be meeting some incredible people, the few remaining voices from Generation Spitfire.
And now, having got our pilot into his seat, complete with cap, goggles, and the rest of the outfit, we have got to lash him in there so that he will not fall out. Wouldn't you hate to be in a straight waistcoat of this kind?
More than 20,000 of these iconic planes took off from British bases during the Second World War. Pilots as young as 19 flew several missions a day, and during the darkest days of the war, one in five of them didn't make it back.
Now the takeoff. Throttle right forward. Stick central. Ease her off the ground. Back with the throttle to normal boost.
I can see her now. Wow, that is something, isn't it? And it looks surprisingly menacing. It looks like that sort of shark with wings on. Blimey. Oh, it looks terrific. It really does.
And John, are you enjoying your trip?
Absolutely fantastic. You look marvellous. I don't mean you personally, but you and the plane.
No, I think I'm just a spare part. I think it's the aeroplane is the best thing.
This is what it'd be like if you were in a Messerschmitt and the Spitfire started to come in and attack you. I can't see anything now. I think I'd have already been shot down if this was in real life. I can't see him. Where is he? Where is that Spitfire? I'm sure he was somewhere.